ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवते उत्तम श्लोकेर भक्तिर भवतीर नष्ट की। सो टुडे वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम कैंटो 5 द क्रिएटिव इंपेटस एंड चैप्टर 10 महाराज रहुगण मीट्स जड भरत एंड द टेक्स्ट इज 10 ऑल्सो। Please repeat after me. Stholyam Karshayam Vyadhaya Adhayascha Shuta Trida Bhayam Kalir Icha Jara Cha Nidra Ratir Manyur Aham मदह शुचो देहेना जातस्य हि मे न संति। स्थौल्यं कार्षयं व्याधादश्च शुत दृढ़ भयं कलिर इच्छा जरा च निद्रा रतिर मन्युर अहम मधा शुचो देहे न जातस्य हि मे न संति। स्थौल्यं कार्षयं व्याध्यादश्च शुत दृढ़ भयं कलिरिच्छा जरा च निद्रा रतिर मन्युर अहम मधा शुचो देहे न जातस्य हि मे न संति। स्थौल्यं कार्ष्यं व्यधश्च तेहेन जातस्य हि मेन संति। माताजी स्थूलं कार्षयं व्याधश्च शुत्रिड़ा भयं कलिर इच्छा जरा च निद्रारतिर्मन्युर अहम मधाशुचो देहे न जातस्य हि मनान शांति। वर्ड टू वर्ड ट्रांसलेशन, ट्रांसलेशन पर्पट by His Divine Grace Abhay Charanarvind Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Please repeat after me. Stholim, being very stout and strong. Karshayam, being skinny and weak. Vyadhaya, the pains of the body, such as disease. Adhaya, the pains of the mind. Cha, and shutrit bhayam, hunger, thirst and fear. Kalihi, quarrels between two persons. Icha, desires. Jara, old age. Cha, and nidra, sleep. Ratihi, attachment for sense gratification. Manihu, anger. Aham, false identification in the bodily concept of life. Madaha, illusion. Shuchaha, lamentation. Dehena, with this body. Jatasya, of one who has taken birth. He certainly may, of me. Na, not. Santi, exist. Translation: fatness, thinness, bodily and mental distress, thirst, hunger, fear, disagreement, desires for material happiness, old age, sleep, attachment for material possessions, anger, lamentation, illusion, and identification of the body with the self are all transformations of the material covering of the spirit soul. A person absorbed in the material bodily conception is affected by these things. But I am free from all bodily conceptions. Consequently, I am neither fat nor skinny nor anything else you have mentioned. Please repeat after me. Fatness, thinness, bodily and mental distress, thirst, hunger, fear, disagreement, desires for material happiness, old age, sleep, attachment for material possessions, anger, lamentation, illusion, and detachment of the body with the self are all transformations of the material covering of the spirit soul. A person absorbed in the material bodily conception is affected by these things. But I am free from all bodily conceptions. Consequently, I am neither fat nor skinny nor anything else you have mentioned. Purport: Srila Narottam Das Thakur has sung, Deha Smriti Nahi Yar samsara bandhana kahatar. One who is spiritually advanced has no connection with the body or with the bodily actions and reactions. When one comes to understand that he is not the body and therefore is neither fat nor skinny, one attains the topmost form of spiritual realization. When one is not spiritually realized, the bodily conception entangles one in the material world. At the present moment, all human society is laboring under the bodily conception. Therefore, in the Shastras, people in this age are referred to as Dvipad Pashu, the two-legged animals. No one can be happy in a civilization conducted by such animals. Our Krishna consciousness movement is trying to raise fallen human society to the status of spiritual understanding. It is not possible for everyone to become immediately realized like Jad Bharat. However, as stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 1-18, Nashta Prayeshva Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya, by spreading the Bhagavad principles, we can raise human society to the platform of perfection. When one is not affected by the bodily conceptions, one can advance to the Lord's devotional service. Nashta Prayeshva Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavate Uttam Shlokir Bhaktir Bhavati Nashtaki. Jai Shishi Radha Madan Mohan Lalita Vishaka Devi Ki Jai, Shishi Gonitai Ki Jai, Krishna Balaram Ki Jai, Prahlad Nisinga Dev Bhagavan Ki Jai. Nashta Prayeshva Bhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavate Uttam Shlokir Bhaktir Bhavati Nashtaki. The more we advance our freedom from the bodily conception, the more we are fixed in devotional service, and the more we are happy and peaceful. In this regard, Srila Madhvacharya says that those who are too materially affected continue the bodily conception. Such persons are concerned with different bodily symptoms, whereas one freed from bodily conceptions lives without the body, even in the material condition. Whereas one freed from bodily conception lives without the body, even in the material condition. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manavabhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamaiham Dadati Swapadantikam Vande Aham Shri Guruho Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Guru Nivaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakan Vitam Sham Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminite Namane Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Paricharane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashchata Deshatarane He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesh Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastate Tapta Kanchan Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vancha Kalpataru Bhishcha Kripa Sindhu Bevacha Patita Nama Pavanebhyo Vishna Vebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram 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 Hare Hare. The text in the translation again. Stholyam Karshayam Vayadhya Adhascha Shut Trid Bhayam Kalir Icha Jaracha Nidra Ratir Manir Aham Madashucho Dehen Jatasya Himena Santi. Fatness, thinness, bodily and mental distress, thirst, hunger, fear, disagreement, desires for material happiness, old age, sleep, attachment for material possessions, anger, lamentation, illusion, and identification of the body with the self are all transformations of the material covering of the spirit soul. A person absorbed in the material bodily conception is affected by these things, but I am free from all bodily conceptions. Consequently, I'm neither fat nor skinny nor anything else you have mentioned. So, just to summarize what's happened so far, very briefly. Lord Rishabhdev's eldest son, Maharaj Bharat, Prince Bharat, who became Maharaj Bharat later on, he ruled for 10 million years, and after that he went to the ashram Palaha Rishi in the Himalayas, where the Gandaki river flows, and he meditated very intensely and deeply, in a serious mood, by which he was able to see and experience the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu. He was in the Bhava platform, but yet, somehow or the other, he became attached to a doe or a baby deer. And there are statements, there are reasons given why a devotee may fall down from the level of a Bhava, which is just below prema and then samadhi. On that level one may fall down. There are reasons given by different devotees. One of the reasons is that it was due to offense in his previous life that he actually fell down. Other reason has been given is to one can't fall down from the level of Bhava. It was arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself to teach all of us a great lesson. After being attached to the doe, Maharaj Bharat, when he left his body, his consciousness was deer consciousness. And as Bhagavad Gita talks about, yam yam api smaranam bhavam. So when he passed away, he became a deer in his next life. But that deer remembered Maharaj Bharat because, and this shows, because this was an arrangement of the Supreme Personality Godhead, he had special mercy from the Lord, he remembered his previous life. So because he remembered his previous life, the deer now, baby deer, he left his company of his mother and friends. He went back to Palha Ashram in the Himalayas and survived on dry leaves rather than green grass. And he left his body thinking of the mistakes he had made. And the next life he became he was born in a high class Brahmin family and he was known as Bharat. But this time, Jad Bharat, because he acted that way, totally oblivious to his surroundings. He acted mute, he acted dumb, he acted ignorant, a fool person. So Jad Bharat, Jad means that, all these symptoms. So he became Jad Bharat and he was taken advantage of by his brothers. Later on, he came across, as we read in the last chapter, a wealthy man, or the king of the dacoits, it is mentioned, the two different things. They were doing a sacrifice, Narbali, or the sacrifice of a human being to Mother Kali. And he did not, Jad Bharat, all his life, he never spoke, never said anything, because it was totally, intensely, deeply, seriously, internally meditating on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He was beyond bodily conceptions of life. Whatever said to him, he did without any thinking of what to do or what was right or what was wrong. He just did it as he was told. So this time, when they took him away as about to kill him, mother herself came, rescued him, killed all the dacoits, and then he went away. And then later on, he was found by the palanquin carriers, because one of them was short. He wasn't performing well, so they found this strong, young person, very strong, very well-built body. They took him, he went, started carrying the palanquin. In the palanquin was King Rahugana from Sindh and Suvir province, which is in Pakistan today, and he was going towards Ganga Sagar to the ashram of Kapil Muni. So this point was also raised the other day. Why was he going in a palanquin? Because palanquin is just used for short distances, not long distances. From all the way from west and to east, there's a distance now of at least 1,000, maybe 1,500 miles to 2,500 kilometers. So the question is, why was he going in a palanquin? Because kings normally go in an entourage with elephants, with horses, in a chariot, etc. Because even then, it'll take days, if not weeks, go on a chariot and elephants. And on go on palanquin will take him months and years. So that's another question which is raised. And the statements or the reasoning behind that is also given. Because if he had went on his chariots in entourage, he would not come across Jad Bharat. But then other question comes, why was he going to Ganga Sagar? So Vishnu Puran talks about that. In Vishnu Puran, King Rahugana, in Vishnu Puran is described Prince Rahugana. Anyway, so King Rahugana tells Jad Bharat when he meets him after the Brahmana Uvacha, Brahman is Jad Bharat here, when Jad Bharat instructs him on spiritual life, Maharaj Rahugana himself states, he said he was going to Ganga Sagar to take instructions from Kapil Muni on spiritual life. But he says that Kapil Muni has arranged in a such a way that he met Jad Bharat himself here nearby rather than going all the way there. So now we reach a point where we find that Jad Bharat has never in his life spoken anything, you know, and never instructed anyone, even though he was provoked, and the severest type of provocation is somebody is about to kill you. Even somebody he was being killed, he did not protest. He just kept quiet. Whatever happens, happens for good. Ishwar Kroti, what's that? Ishwar Yat Kroti Shobhanam Kroti. So whatever happens, happens for the best, and whatever God arranges, arranges for the best. So that was his thinking. And he was just in his meditation. Come death, whether he lives, whether he dies, he did not protest. One may say, there was a right opportunity to preach. There was also an opportunity to preach to the dacoits. Because dacoit, the head of the dacoit was also a leader. And preaching to the leader, whether you're a dacoit or a leader of the society, which are not dacoits, it's a one and same thing. But he did not preach. He did not preach to anyone. He did not preach to his family, his brothers, to the society, to the dacoits, even though he was being killed. But yet he preached to King Rahugana. Why? There's another why comes. And as explained the other day in the class, one reason, or couple of reasons came. One, here was an opportunity to preach. But that opportunity existed before, but he did not preach. But other reason comes because King Rahugana is the same deer or same doe who came back as King Rahugana, who Maharaj Bharat reared, who brought up. And because of that affection he had, Vatsalya Bhav, he wanted to bring that deer up to the level of Mahabhagwat like himself. So that's another reason given why King Rahugana was actually spoken, not anyone else. And then after speaking to King Rahugana, Maharaj Bharat never spoke to anyone else again. He just left, he went, wandered off. So only time he spoke was in this instance where we are actually discussing now. Yesterday was first verse where he spoke, and today is the second one. Yesterday he said, it's a long verse, basically, but King, even though King Rahugana sarcastically criticized him. It did not affect Maharaj Bharat. Even though King Rahugana showed his authority, he said, look, I am a king here. I can send you to the abode of Yamaraj. He did not protest. He spoke not because of his criticism. He spoke not because of sarcasm. Because he spoke, he wanted to deliver him. And this is where these two verses are being said. And in today's verse, the Brahmana Uvacha, Jad Bharat is saying, he's talking about the qualities, or he's making statements, the aspects. He's talking about the aspects which distinguish one who is in a bodily conception of life and one who is not on bodily conception of life. What are those aspects? One can give a whole seminar, long classes on these, but we won't touch on that, we just discuss it. What are those aspects? The aspect is fatness. If one identifies oneself with these aspects of one's existence, if one thinks one's existence is body, because that's what it is referring to, and Jad Bharat saying to King, hey Maharaj, fatness, thinness, bodily and mental distress, thirst, anger, fear, disagreement, desire for material happiness, old age, sleep, attachment for material possessions, anger, lamentation, illusion and identification of the body, body with the self, are all transformations of the body, the covering of the soul. And person absorbed in these aspects is on the bodily conception of life. So here's a list, a checklist. Are we on bodily conception of life? Here's a list. Am I fat? Am I fat? Do I think I'm thin? Do I think I have a mental distresses? Do I think I'm hungry? Do I think I'm thirsty? Do I disagree with others? Desires for material happiness? Old age, am I affected by old age? Am I affected by sleep, attachment to material possessions? Anger, lamentations, illusion and identification? Are the checklist. I can say for myself, yes, 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 yes. All of them. Right. So here is the checklist which Jad Bharat is given to Maharaj Rahugana. And it's important for us to make sure we go through the checklist and remember and always remind ourselves, what platform am I on? Am I artificially being on a different platform? Am I really on this level? And Prabhupada in his purport talks about this. He says, not everyone it is not possible, Prabhupada says in the purport, for everyone to become immediately self-realized like Jad Bharat. Not possible. Impossible, he says. Immediately. But eventually, yes. Because that is a goal. That is a goal of every devotee in ISKCON who has taken up devotional service, to become self-realized, go beyond bodily conception of life. But the danger, the caveat, the warning Prabhupada is also giving is that not all of us like Katvang Maharaj. You know, within a second he became self-realized and went back to Godhead. For most, at least for some of us, there's a whole process one has to follow. The process is known as sadhana bhakti. And while going on the process, these are the checklists which is Jad Bharat is giving to King Rahugana. And we have to constantly check them. We have to constantly remind where we are at and not be artificially on a different level. If one tries to be on a level which one is not at, but artificially raises oneself, then unfortunately in many cases one doesn't stay in any level. You know, the higher level or even the lower level. Eventually one just slips away, falls down. So one has to be very careful, not be under any pressure. It is better to go the speed of a hare than the speed of a rabbit. Because it's sure and steady with practice, and that is what the aim is.
on that. And
Srila Prabhupada starts with Narottam Das Thakur's bhajan, Deha Smriti Nahi Yaar, Samsara Bandhan Kahatar. So the one who's not on the bodily conception, Deha Smriti, then he, that individual, is not shackled, bound by the bondages of this world. And actually there are two, there may be more, but the two main individuals who are not on Deha Smriti. Can anyone say? Two of the major, those two individuals who are not on Deha Smriti, one we're just reading about, a Mahabhagavat, Jad Bharat, and the other one? One who's mad, yes. Anyone else? One who's not bodily conception of life. We've probably seen it in our lives. Some of us been through that stage with friends, families, we see on TV. One who's totally drunk. One who's intoxicated. When one is totally intoxicated, in fact, that individual may be more on non-bodily concept of life, maybe beyond bodily concept of life, it apparently. Because when one totally is drunk, it doesn't care where he is, where she is, wherever he is lying, whatever he is doing. And some of the things people do when they go totally drunk, you'll be amazed. I can remember the days of my college and university, some of my friends, the things they did when they got drunk. We don't want to mention that here, but totally, it seems, they don't care about anything else in the world. So these are the two types, but obviously they're ignorant, mode of ignorance. But we don't want to be like that. We want to be beyond bodily concept of life with knowledge, in mode of goodness. And that is the aim, that's Jad Bharat did. He was totally self-realized, totally in level of spiritual knowledge. And one who is spiritually advanced has no connection with the body. So here's Prabhupada is pointing out, what is the criteria? How to judge ourselves, whether we are progressing. Jai Shri Shri Radha Madan Mohan, Lalita Vishakha Devi ki jai, Shri Shri Gonitai ki jai, Krishna Balaram ki jai, Prahlad Narasingadev Bhagwan ki jai. Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur he used to tell this very famous story, we all know it, about the wedding party, going to one village, going to another village beyond, on a river or a lake, when the village party said to the boatman, take us to the other side, and it was night, dark, so the village party stays on the boat, the boatman rows, and next morning they find they're still there. They were thinking they reached the other side of the bank, river bank, but they're still there. Why? Because the boatman did not take the anchor out. It doesn't matter how much they tried, the boatman tried rowing, how much effort they put in, still, because the anchor was firmly fixed on the river bed, the boat did not move. Similarly, that is with some of us. We may try so much hard, we may try strenuously on the path of devotional service, on the path of bhakti or sadhana bhakti. But sometimes our anchor is still stuck on the bodily concept of life. And unless and until the anchor is there, it is very difficult to make progress. Doesn't matter how much endeavor we make on the path of devotional service. Sometimes one tries to have the best of both worlds. One foot here, one foot another, thinking I'm balanced, I'm doing okay. So one tries, and yes, one may go one foot forward, two back, but because the anchor being still there, the progress is very difficult to make. So this anchor of bodily concept of life, we have to get rid of or take out and get rid of it totally. Otherwise, as Srila Prabhupada points out, there's no difference between a four-legged animal or a two-legged animal. Dvipad Pashu. And Srila Prabhupada always made this point. He said this modern civilization is based on a mistake. And what is a mistake? Everyone thinks they're the body. Everyone. And the whole modern civilization is geared around that, to satisfy the needs of the body, whether it's advertisements or other items, selling, advertising, brainwashing, etc., whatever, is for sense enjoyment, nothing else. Sense gratification and nothing else. And Srila Prabhupada, when he was asked, what does he think about the modern civilization? I think it was in London, when he came to London, one of the reporters asked him, what do you think of the Western civilization? And Srila Prabhupada said, it's a good idea. So he totally dismissed it, because it's based on bodily concept of life. And one may think one is advanced because one is on the human bodily level. Yes, they are on human bodily level. Unless they move away from bodily level, go on a platform of spirituality, we all remain two-legged animals. And then Prabhupada says, how to elevate or alleviate ourselves from this two-legged animal consciousness. How we can do it ourselves, and how we can raise the platform, the mentality of the platform of society we live in. Because that is the aim. Srila Prabhupada points out, the aim of ISKCON. What is the aim of ISKCON? The aim of ISKCON is to raise human society to the platform of perfection. By spreading what? By spreading the principles of Bhagavad. Bhagavad means Bhagavad principles, principles of Bhagavad Puran, and devotional service. And Srila Prabhupada quotes Advash, Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu Nityam Bhagavad Sevya. And in the purport of this verse, Prabhupada says there are two types of Bhagavad, the book Bhagavad and the devotee Bhagavad. And by serving the devotee Bhagavad, as well as by serving the book Bhagavad, one follows the principles of Bhagavad, and by which one can raise ourselves and raise the society in general. Because after all, ISKCON is not a Bhajanandi movement, it's a Goshtianandi movement. It's there to spread the message of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, as Srila Prabhupada himself showed how to do that. And he was an ideal example of not being on a bodily concept of life. Once in Watford, in England, near the manor, Srila Prabhupada, in his last visit, I'm not sure, he was taken to Watford Hospital. And because he was so weak, it looked like purely bag of bones from a material point of view. So the doctors, when they examined it, they were shocked. They said, person in such condition, normally 99.9999% of the population in the world in such condition will be crying, will be wailing and screaming of pain. We will have to give that individual morphine to calm him down. But here's Prabhupada not being affected at all. He was totally transcendental to the bodily concept of life. And the more, Prabhupada points out later on this verse, the more we fixed on the bodily concept of life, on the spiritual concept of life, beyond bodily concept of life, more happy we are and more progress we make. Because the anchor is coming out slowly. Unless we do that, and if we keep the anchor there, we don't make progress. And Srila Madhvacharya, Srila Prabhupada points out, also says that those who are too materially affected, they continue bodily conception, i.e. they continue on a bodily, in their future lives, they will continue on a bodily concept of life. They will take birth in 8,400,000 species of life, not necessarily human life, not necessarily human platform. And such persons are, whereas one is freed from bodily concepts, lives without the body, even in the material condition. Here is the key. Last sentence of the purport, as Srila Prabhupada points out, it is not possible for everyone to become like Jad Bharat. So how does one do that? And earlier on, Prabhupada says, by following the principles of sadhana bhakti. But then, sometimes it also becomes very difficult to follow the principles of sadhana bhakti. And then, Prabhupada is pointing out, it is possible. One can become जीवन मुक्त से उच्चते कर्मणा मनसा गिरा निखलाव अप्यवस्थासु जीवन मुक्त उच्चते. इवन दिस मटेरियल प्लेटफॉर्म वन कैन बी बियॉन्ड द बॉडली कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ लाइफ बट हाउ बाय एक्सपीरियंसिंग एज लॉर्ड कृष्ण पॉइंट्स आउट भगवद्गीता 259 परम दृष्टो निवर्तते बाय एक्सपीरियंसिंग हाई टेस्ट. But that, at the same time, is not a platform to become complacent. Yes, because, and in the last verse of the purport, Prabhupada points it out, because of the austerities and renunciation, Jad Bharat showed, in fact, this austerity and renunciation is very common in India, and Jad Bharat has shown that, and it has been for ages and ages. We find, like Kumbh Mela today, which is going on, you may have seen in the photographs, you may have seen opposite Ram Janardhan temple, there are hatha yogis, they're practicing their yoga. And what time they practice? Between 11 and 2 o'clock. 11 o'clock in the morning and 2 o'clock in the afternoon, when the temperature is 41, 42, 43 degrees. And that is not enough. They hardly got any clothes on. They're sitting on the middle of the sunshine, 43 degrees. And that's not enough for them. They have fire lit around them, and some of them have fire on top of the head lit, and they practice yoga. So this austerity and renunciation actually is part and parcel of our the Vedas, the processes. Ashtanga yoga, and Prabhupada points it out, is a practice of austerity and penance, is meant for understanding the distinction between the body and the soul. In the last purport of the last verse, what is that verse? 18:5, danam yagyas, austerity, penance, and charity is meant for purifying even the most advanced people. So penance is very important. So ashtanga yogis, hatha yogis do that. But, and they're totally detached. They become detached. And this concept is not actually present in India in the past. Because the Vedic culture was spread all over the world, this was very much prevalent in other cultures of the world. For example, Diogenes, a great philosopher of Greece. In fact, the Greek Empire was found by one of the kings from India. So this philosopher Diogenes, very great philosopher, contemporary of Plato, etc. Where did he used to live? In a barrel, wooden barrel outside. He was a beggar. He used to live in a barrel, and he was totally renunciate. Or Saint Francis of Assisi, for example, in Italy. So there's so many examples. So once Alexander the Great came to visit Diogenes, he said, I've heard so much about you. I want to render some, because Alexander was the king at that time, I want to render some service to you. And this philosopher, totally renunciate, he said to Alexander the Great, he said, get out of my way, you're blocking the sun. That was his reply. But we find here a Brahmana, coming back to Jad Bharat. Now, Jad Bharat, if you look at it from different point of view, what is Jad Bharat doing here? He's answering, although he's being chastised by the king, and he's answering him back. He's teaching him a lesson. That is a Brahmana. That's the quality of a Brahmana. Brahmana is fearless. He speaks the truth. He's not obliged to anyone. Unlike the Brahmanas and the sadhus of today, they're obliged, they're bought, they're on somebody's payrolls, they get bribed, and because of that, they can't speak the truth. They can't tell what is right, what is wrong. Because, just like in Mahabharata we find, the great acharyas, Dronacharya, even Kripacharya, even Bhishma Dev, they were under the payroll of Duryodhan. Something was going wrong. disrobing of Draupadi, they kept quiet because they were in the peril. That's not a Brahmana. Kripacharya was a Brahmana. Dronacharya was a Brahmana. Yet, they kept quiet. But Brahmana is not like that. Jad Bharat, he didn't think, oh, he's a great king. Can you imagine to Brahmanas of today? If somebody comes, a great authority comes, and tells you something and you answer them back? No. Hardly anyone will do that. We find in Kumbh Mela, people are like that. The Prime Minister of India organized one function here near Ujjain. He only came, the function was for a couple of hours. He came, most people, yes, wow, what a wonderful event the Prime Minister organized, wonderful, giving him, congratulating him, etc. But there's some, they're voicing against him. He said, what a nonsense the Prime Minister did. You know, he would just talked about politics. So there are some individuals who do speak up. They speak the truth. But most don't, because they're on somebody's payroll. And that's what Jad Bharat was doing. He wasn't thinking, oh, he's my king, so I just accept what he's telling me. Although he's chastising me, I should keep quiet. But when the point came of telling the truth, especially telling about the absolute truth, no one should keep quiet. One should stay. One should speak up. Because that is the quality of Brahmin. Shamadama tapashosham shantim arjumam. Arjum, being honest, is the most important quality. One has to be honest and straightforward. And that's what Jad Bharat is teaching. And we find, there's so many lessons we can learn from this Leela of Jad Bharat. And the main thing is attachment. Attachment brings misery, as I say. And once shy, twice bitten. Because once he made a mistake, he did not make the mistake again. So one has to learn from one's experience, as he did in the body of a deer. And one has to learn, another lesson is the attachment factor. Asakti is the cause of all the bodily concept of life. And then we also learn when he was in the deer, that he was so determined, as in Jad Bharat, once bitten, twice shy, he became so determined. So another lesson we can learn, how to be determined in our path of this devotional life. So many lessons we can learn from this particular aspect. But coming back, the question, the main sentence for me in this purport, it is not possible for everyone to become immediately realized like Jad Bharat. Yes, we have to strive for that. That is our goal. But one has to be practical, one has to be honest with oneself, one has to realize at what stage we are at. After all, this is Varnashram Dharma. And Prabhupada wanted to establish that. And we always talk about ashrams. We hardly talk about Varnas. So we have to be practical, honest, and not on artificial level. And if we progress with the speed of a hare, with surely and steadily, then we will achieve what Jad Bharat did. And the way and the quickest process, Srila Prabhupada is pointing out, is to preach. Because after all, ISKCON is a preaching movement, and that is the quickest process by which. And we notice that as long as one is in the association of devotees, as long as one is preaching, as long as one is doing service, temporarily, one goes beyond the bodily concept. One doesn't have time to think about those things which affect us, i.e. sense gratification. But as soon as one stops doing service, away from association, away from preaching, then all these thoughts, idle mind is devil's workshop, as we know, all these thoughts come, and eventually one goes back to the bodily concept of life. So the key is stay high forever. Not being by drunk, but being in knowledge and following the process of devotional service, as Srila Prabhupada is pointing out. I think I'd like to stop here. If there's any corrections, comments or questions we can have, otherwise we can finish today. Okay. Thank you very much. Granth Raj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.